In the film The Presidio, Sean Connery and Mark Harmon play two lawmen in a story that calls for them to do a lot of very physical action. Mark's experience as a college quarterback came in very handy when negotiating this realistic chase scene, and clearly he's doing everything himself. Shot mainly on location, the film is both directed and photographed by Peter Hyams, who relies heavily on veteran stunt coordinator Glenn Wilder to help bring originality to the sequence. In turn, Mark and his stunt double, Norman Howell, work on who can best sell a shot.
I've worked with Norman for quite a while, and I trust his judgment implicitly. If he tells me he thinks it's difficult and he should handle it alone, I let him handle it alone. And most times, he'll do it, and then I'll do it. And hopefully that gives the editor an advantage that he might not have in other instances. And I don't care about any of it as long as the scene wins. I'm no hero about the stunt part of it, and I'll do whatever I need to do to make it believable for the character, but Norman Howell looks more like me than I look like me, so I let him do the really hard stuff.
Roll both cameras. And be calm and mark.
Action, guys.
With fellow stuntman Steve Kelso doubling the heavy, Norman replaces Mark for this brief but risky piece of action.
Roll camera, please. Ready?
Mark then comes in to do the close shot, which still demands exceptional agility and acting ability. At 12, Norman Howell was given a part in a John Wayne Western. He was immediately drawn to the easygoing nature of the stuntmen and decided he had to become one of them.
And I just started picking up information from all these older stunt guys, Tommy Huff, Terry Leonard. I just started listening. For 10 years, I never talked. I listened, you know. I can't recall ever being on a set and saying, no, I can't do that, or no, I will not do that.
Norman, doubling the star of MacGyver, Richard Dean Anderson, regards the upcoming spectacular stunt as something special in his long list of awesome credits. It didn't faze him that no one had ever done it before.
It was exhilarating. I had so much fun doing that because it went so smoothly that I wanted to do it again. The director said, no, we don't need it again. It was great. It's one of the few times when I really wanted to do the stunt again. Through meeting Billy Burton, I did a job called Octopussy, where I doubled James Bond, which was, to me, you know, a highlight. That was difficult to train for because there was an airplane taxiing down the runway, and I had to ride up behind it on a horse and leap ahead of my horse and land on the tail of the beach craft.
Norman was 25 years old at the time he literally boarded and held on to the aircraft as it lifted off the ground. For the balance of this unique sequence, however, Roger Moore would be doubled by aerial specialist Jake Lombard. It would require 4 weeks filming at 7 to 8,000 feet to get James Bond out of this ultimate cliffhanger predicament. The stunt had never been done before, and while there's a parachute under Jake's jacket, there were many risks entailed by moving about the speeding plane.
As we're diving, the wardrobe exploded and inflated with air. And I didn't want to take a chance on deploying the parachute into the torn wardrobe, so I just hung on until it was all over. Of course, then you got to go do it again because the coat looked terrible in camera.
During the fight sequence, Jake engages B.J. Wirth, doubling the heavy in an authentic duel, which was all the more dangerous for having two men performing miles high at 120 miles an hour. BJ vividly recalls this challenge.
In my position, I had to have my back to the wind, and that was the most difficult part, to the most trying, because sometimes I'd come very near the tail, and we had to do it 18 times, I guess, from different angles, different cameras, and in the end, it worked out okay, but it was sort of tricky.
Needless to say, the Bond pictures have brought stunt work to new heights. In Dodge City, the 1939 Western, the classic barroom brawl, a field day for Hollywood stuntmen for whom these huge free-for-alls were a lot of work. Noticeably absent among the chaos is the star, Errol Flynn. An unrehearsed punch or flying object might have done him in.
Stop it, you fool! Stop it, I said!
But times have changed. For the film Roadhouse, Patrick Swayze plays a professional bouncer with a talent for kickboxing. Long, complex fight scenes will require his complete participation. No double at all, most of the time. Choreographing the action for the many elaborate brawls is Charlie Pacioni, outstanding stunt coordinator of such films as Die Hard. No one throws a punch without his staging it first, both to ensure it's true to the film and safe. And when Sam pushes Tony back, he suggests to director Rowdy Harrington what co-star Sam Elliott should do next.
You got that, but you're going to turn back into it. You can get this if you want, but...
The old fights are still entertaining. What we try to do now is try and put different types of fights in movies. I think fights that fit the characters, you know, more than just doing a fight for the sake of doing a fight. I think it's always interesting to make it fit the character, make the story work.
I love these guys. Half my friends are stuntmen. And it's interesting, and they're a real interesting lot because, you know, it's a macho trade, you know? Yet, 9 times out of 10, they don't play macho. They don't try to act like I'm the baddest of the bad. They're good people, and they're in touch with their vulnerability and their sensitivity. Charlie, he doesn't just go by the numbers and just stick in stuff. He goes from a dynamic and emotional point of view of what emotionally needs to happen in this moment for the movie, not just so he can throw in neat stunts. And to me, that makes a powerful stunt coordinator.
That works much better.
He's a lot of fun. He's up. I think the positive energy that he pumps into it is full energy. You know, I mean, he's nonstop all the time. And that's real infectious, that kind of energy. And the other thing I think I'd say about Charlie is he's not going to settle for anything. And that, too, is what puts him on top where he is, I think. The fact that he doesn't compromise his shots.
Good.
In the business, Charlie and other leading colleagues are noted for their personal commitment to each film. A case in point occurred in First Blood, the first Rambo film. Stuntman Benny Dobbins is driving the police car chasing Sylvester Stallone. A high-speed ramp jump is called for, but the car lands with unexpected impact, and Benny's back is broken. Yet he completes the scene and returns to work 6 months later. Benny continues working as a foremost stunt coordinator, and along the way, becomes mentor to a new superstar.
I met Benny Dobbins around 3 months before we filmed the film Commando. We met at lunch, and he explained to me how he works. And he told me that he believes very strongly in the stars doing most of their own stunts. But he said, that's not very easy, obviously. He says, for that, you have to be willing to go under some severe training. And I say, one of those things, right? And he said, listen, I'm going to give you the best trainer for fight scenes, so you can do high kicks up to faces, no matter how tall the guys are. I give you guys to teach you how to jump off buildings and do all in the airbag. So to me, Benny Dobbins was a very, very important person in my career because he enlightened me to all these things about stunts and about courage when you do stunts and training for it. You look at it and you say, wait a minute, you want me to do this? You want me to jump off an elevator? 20 feet down into this airbag, wait a minute, yeah? But the way he did it was in a very casual way, and he jumped, and he says, you see, it's a piece of cake, try it, come on. And I remember one stunt we did on Commando where I had to kind of run through a French door. I never got hurt, with Benny Dobbins coordinating the film. They were dangerous stunts, but I never got hurt. And I think if it wouldn't have been for Benny, I wouldn't have been making movies today because I would have broken many bones by now.
Red Heat would be their last picture together. The film is dedicated to Benny.
Because he died on the film while he was working. He died during a scene where we were out in the snow, freezing cold during the fight sequence. And he literally died putting wooden boards out there in the snow so we don't have to freeze our ass off with our feet in the snow. He was, while he was doing that work, you know, he passed out and then he never came back. You had to admire the whole Benny Dobbins, which is also the way he talked about his family, the way he loved his wife, the way he loved his children, that usually you don't see much in this town. People talk about, you know, me, 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 me. But no one talks about those things that everyone else out there in the country talks about, family, love, affection, loyalty, and things like that. So he will always be like kind of a teacher to us in those areas too. But whenever I think of Benny, I think of a mentor. I think of him as a friend and a guy that assisted me, not only with stunts, but with everything in life. And now he's a great loss.
Today's action stars depend on stuntmen, not just for the high-risk shots. To create a convincing, lasting image of a heroic figure, an actor must continually learn new physical moves which support his character. He knows who he can count on for help. The automobile, an invention like the movies themselves, identified with America's desire for speed and adventure.